Hey, I'm Shane with a handle on things. If you've got a Goodman brand furnace like the one I've got, or any other gas-operated furnace, and the furnace won't turn on or the furnace won't ignite, a basic understanding of how gas furnaces operate might save you a lot of trouble and maybe a lot of money. So stick around. I'll show you the four main things that usually fail and keep a gas-operated furnace from working properly. And I'll show you how I fix them on my furnace. So here's my situation. I live a gazillion miles from nowhere, and I have a Goodman gas furnace that provides the primary heat for my house. And every year or two, when summer comes to a close, I turn on the furnace and something doesn't want to work right with it. Well, guess what? Summer just came to a close, I turned on my furnace and it doesn't want to light. Well, let's see if we can sort this out and get a handle on things in the furnace room. My furnace is located in a small furnace room, so getting to it can be a bit tricky, especially for filming. Here's a quick tip. Put your furnace model number and serial number in a spot where they're very easy to find when you need them. This will save you a lot of aggravation later. Let's pull the access panels off the furnace and have a look. I'll remove the top panel where the burner is located. And the bottom panel where the control board can usually be found. In the bottom compartment, there's a safety door switch. If the plunger on this switch is out of position because the access door is off, the furnace won't run. The control board has line voltage supplied to it. In my case, that's 115 volts. I'll be careful what I touch in here. In the upper compartment, we find the pressure switch. It's attached to the blower fan with a rubber hose. This is the burner assembly. On the flame side of the burners, we find the igniter. Hey, could you do us a favor? Take just a second and hit that like and subscribe button. You wouldn't believe how much it helps the channel out. Thanks. And the flame sensor. On the side of my furnace is an electrical shutoff switch and the gas supply shutoff valve. All of the switches and sensors on the furnace connect to the control board. My furnace isn't lighting, so I'm going to have a look at the igniter first. The igniter is connected by a plug in the upper compartment. After shutting down the breaker to the furnace and shutting off the gas supply for safety, I'll detach the igniter at the plug. The igniter is held in place with two sheet metal screws. After removing the screws, the igniter lifts out easily. This igniter has a lot of soot built up on it, and I found a crack in the porcelain, so I'm going to replace it. I ordered a new igniter from eBay. It cost me about 15 bucks. The furnace part shop in town wanted 60 bucks for the same igniter. I inspect the new igniter. There should be no breaks in the coil. Everything looks good. The holes in this mounting plate are the same distance apart as the other igniter, so it's looking good so far. I install the new igniter and plug it back in. The plug is set up so it only goes together one way. Can't mess this one up. While I'm at it, I'll clean the flame sensor. It's also located in front of the burners on this furnace. I remove the one screw holding it in place and pull it out. The flame sensor also has soot on it. It doesn't have to be very dirty and the furnace will start acting up, so I'll clean it. The flame sensor is cleaned with acetone, fingernail polish remover, that's the same thing. I never use abrasives to clean this sensor. There's only one wire attached to the sensor, and it looks okay here. I reinstalled the sensor. The pressure vacuum switch tells the control board that the burner blower fan is working. It knows that because the fan creates a suction through the rubber tube that trips the pressure switch. I detach the rubber hose and verify that the hose is in good condition. Then I suck on the rubber hose and listen to the switch click. This is an indication that the suction will cause the switch to operate. This doesn't mean the switch is good, but it does mean it's tripping with pressure at least. I've had plugged hoses, but I've never had a bad switch. Well, yet. I plug the hose back into the fan housing. After replacing the igniter, cleaning the flame sensor, and checking the pressure switch, I check to see if the furnace is now working. Usually it'll work fine at this point, and I can close up the furnace and move on. I've turned the thermostat up, turned the gas on, and turned on the power, and I'm holding the door switch in to check the furnace operation. The burner fan has come on, and it's evacuating any gas that may be present prior to the ignition sequence. Well, at this point the igniter should start glowing, but that isn't happening. That's not a good sign. After about 2 minutes, the furnace starts blinking a failure code. This is a single flash code. It keeps repeating, but it's a single flash code. I check the chart to see what a single flash code means, and I have an ignition failure. I've already checked the things it says to check. A quick look at the furnace schematic tells me that the igniter should be getting 115 to 120 volts of AC power when it's supposed to initiate. The schematic says that bold lines are high voltage and thin lines are low voltage on this furnace. Now this is a multimeter. You can get one at a home improvement center for as little as 10 bucks. You really ought to have one. I set it to read up to 200 volts of AC power. And I plug the leads into the wires that are supposed to supply the line voltage to the igniter. It doesn't matter which lead goes to which wire with AC power. Then I cycle the furnace again to see how much power the control board is supplying when it's time to ignite the furnace. Well, the control board isn't sending any power when it's time to ignite the furnace. I now know that something is wrong with the control board. After all, the igniter can't work if it isn't getting power. So I shut off the breaker and the gas supply again for safety. The control board is mounted to the furnace on a series of little plastic buttons. A little squeeze on the plastic buttons and they release the control board easily. The control board part number is printed in the margins of the control board. I'm going to need this so that I can order a new control board. Well, now I guess we know why the control board quit me, don't we? This mouse shorted the high voltage side of the control board with his body. He won't be doing that again anytime soon. I found a new control board on eBay for less than $100. The furnace parts store in town? Yeah, they wanted $200 for the same board. Try not to give the new board a static shock. Well, tell that to the mouse. I checked the part number on the new board. People make mistakes sometimes. This looks like the right one, though. Then I checked the paperwork that came with the new board to make sure they haven't made any improvements that are going to require my attention. No surprises on this one. That's good. Now we're going to remove the wires from the old board one at a time and plug them into the correct locations on the new board. One at a time is the key. That way you can't get confused. The 9-pin connector can only plug in one way. That's a no-brainer. Okay, I one at a timed my way through all of the wires and connections, and the new board is now all hooked up. I'll pop it back onto the little plastic mounting buttons. Time to turn on the breaker and the gas supply again. And then I'll hold the door switch in and we'll see if the furnace will light this time. If all things are working, the igniter should start to glow after about a minute. And there it is. And the furnace lit. And it kept running. Now that's a good deal. Now, just for those of us who want to see how many volts the igniter should be getting if the board is working right, there it is, 123 volts AC. That's line voltage in this case. I zip tied all the wires again, and I'm going to clean up this filthy furnace just a little bit. And with the access panels back on, my furnace now works exactly like it's supposed to. Well, I'd say that I saved myself about $600 on this project, but the truth is that most of the furnace guys I've run into don't like replacing control boards. They would have just tried to sell me a new furnace instead. So I saved a ton of money.